by eminent industry leaders. For our first keynote, may I request Mr. Shivakumar, Sriraman, Chief Risk Officer, India and South Asia, Visa, to share his views on the topic, Securing the Future of Payments in a Connected World. Mr. Shivakumar.
Good morning. So I've been given a topic to talk about securing the future of payments. I initially prepared slides for COVID-19, make it slightly short, so I'll try and wrap it up as early as possible. Before I start my presentation, my legal team insists saying I'll put the disclaimer saying whatever I say, some of them carry future statements, so don't trade in Visa shares just because I told something is going to happen. So finish that. I would like to start my presentation with a video.
The Brexit vote has passed.
Korea goes to the beach.
Brazilians are outraged by a scandal.
You are fake news.
In the cryptocurrency space, Bitcoin is the 800-pound gorilla.
New business models with connected wearables, connected cars, even connected loans.
Thousand cryptocurrency notes will no longer be legal tender.
An increase in automation of 3D printing across all industries.
Delivered by drone right to your door.
The explosion of big data is having a big impact.
85% of people don't trust institutions that impact their lives.
Today's breach at Yahoo is the largest hack in history.
Turning to the internet.
Businesses lost tens of thousands of dollars.
Online credit card fraud is growing.
So just to give you a glimpse of what are the changes we are witnessing in the payment space, we all know we are going more and more digital, right? Especially post-demonetization, there is a constant push. Chikipilai also said in the morning, the government is fully focused on digital. be it on various aspects, be it on across industries. But especially in the payment space, the future is now. We are already into digital. And how are we planning to secure that? And we are also seeing the ecosystem getting more and more complex with more and more players entering into the payment space. Traditionally, if you see, it's a banker's domain. It used to be a four-party model where two bankers are involved, there is a customer involved, there is a point of sale, which is a merchant or a merchant establishment is involved. That can be virtual or physical. Those are the traditional models, but now it's evolved. There are more players which have come into play, there are more ways to be paid. Today, the form factors are changing. It's no longer a physical card. Your watch has become a payment mode. Your shirt has become a payment mode. Your glove has become a payment mode. Everything is talking about payments. And today, your mobile manufacturers are getting into payments. Your social networks are getting into payments. It's only going to get more and more complex in this space. And we've also seen increased government involvement in the payment space because of too many things happening. They are trying to regulate this market, and more governments, especially in emerging markets, also want to move into less cash economy. And going digital is one way of achieving that, right? So we are seeing more and more government getting involved in shaping the ecosystem agenda in the payment space. Obviously, for people who are focusing on security, we are seeing the threats are going, we are seeing a paradigm shift in the threat landscape, right? If you ask anybody who is in the payment space over the last 15, 20 years, the way they looked at risk, the way they managed risk, probably a decade back, is completely different from what they're doing today. They no longer can talk about building process, people, and solutions or technology which were working for them 15 years back will not work today. You ask anybody, I can 100% guarantee you, they must have upgraded from what they've been doing in 15 years back. Okay. The threats are completely changing. The cyber threats are completely changing, and that's what is going to be the future threats in the payment landscape. So we all know changes coming fast, right? we talked about in the earlier panel, I just wanted to quote what Nitin said, right? Today, the whole landscape is changing in a way saying it's no longer just a banking instrument. It's more of a consumer experience. They're moving away from a transaction to a consumer experience. That's the change. And just to give you a perspective of what is the impact of this change for Visa, it took 60 years to achieve 3 billion cards in the world. And the prediction of Internet of Things is 20 billion devices by 2020. And each of these IoT devices want to be a payment carrier. 2020 is just 2 years away. We took 60 years to achieve 3 billion cards, which are a payment credential, which used to be the legacy and traditional way of making payments. We're talking about IoT devices. Even if you take 50% conservatively, want to be a payment carrier, you're talking about 10 billion devices in the next 2 years, which is going to act as a payment channel. So that's scary. How do we protect that? And it's not just one industry which is talking about IoT, right? You take any industry for that matter, people want to get into Internet of Things. So that's what we want to. And what is less clear, we all know this is going to happen. And what is less clear is, what is the path to secure this connected world? What do we need to do as an industry? What do we need to do as an ecosystem to ensure security also tags along with innovation? How do we balance this equation? That's what I wanted to probably drive around in the next 3 minutes. Just to touch upon what are the drivers of change, one is the boom in fintech. There are studies which say that from 2006 to 2016, the fintech investments have gone 10x. It was 3.6 billion, it's close to 36 billion, which is focusing only on financial technology. And all of these are primarily focusing on payments. And that's the steep increase we have seen, just to validate what Nitin said in the earlier panel, to improve the consumer experience. The second is Internet of Things, I talked about it, 20 billion devices. The growth of mobile. As we speak today, the number of internet users through mobile has increased extremely high. On a global level, 50% of the population today are internet users. And almost everybody uses it on their handheld phones. We are seeing that, which used to be probably not even 10-15% if you take 5 years, 10 years back, right? That's the growth we have seen on the mobile sector. And the moment you start accessing internet on handheld devices, people talk about convenience. Security slightly takes the back seat. That's what is slightly concerning, right? We all know innovation is good. We all know it's increasing the digital space. But how do we take care of the security aspect? That is what we need to think as an industry. And the cyber threats are changing. It's completely changing the landscape. Previously, I don't want to talk about various actors, threat actors involved, state actors or hackers or people who are professional cybercrime, people who are involved in doing all this. That's a separate topic altogether. But what we are seeing is people who are trying to do cyber attacks are focusing on probing issuer controls. When I mean issuer controls, the bankers today completely rely on certain controls when it comes to payment transactions, right? Because trust builds this payment system over a period of time. Today, if I as a consumer want to do a transaction using my card or my account and trying to make a payment, I trust the system saying if I do it, the recipient will be able to receive the payment. Anything which impacts this trust will create irrational decisions on the consumer. How do we stop, how do we ensure this trust is robust and trust is intact in this changing dynamic world and securing the connected world? That is what, when I said probing issuer controls, I just want to give you an example of most of the people in the room will be knowing about the cash out attack which happened with one of the banks here. That's a classic example, right? The bank had a switch which is probably approving the transaction without even checking for basic checks the switch is supposed to do. The switch is designed to do check for balance, check whether it's blocked, check whether it's a closed account, whether it's live account, available balance. But that itself is being stopped and the malware is able to approve a transaction without doing the basic checks. That's disastrous. And more such instances are happening, and they're targeting a time period which is lean, weekends, holidays, on Sundays, early mornings, where bank monitoring controls are much weaker. and they are maximizing it. And it's targeted in such a way saying they're able to extract an incident in Japan where they're able to extract close to 18 million in a span of 4.5 hours, $18 million, US dollars. Just in a span of 4.5 hours, targeting with just 120 people, targeting 2,500 ATMs, 3,000 cars. It's a very organized cybercrime incident which has happened. But that's shifting at a much rapid pace. We all know this is a complicated equation, right? When we talk about security and innovation driving in parallel, it's a complicated. How do we balance this? How do we ensure we also tag along with innovation? How do we build security by design? Those are the things which we need to think through. I'll also talk about what are the various aspects which we are thinking through from visa perspective on a long-term, short-term perspective as well. But just wanted to talk about this. We talked about this, more ways to pay. Creates also more respect because the number of players in the ecosystem are only going to increase. And when your touch points are more and more, there is more opportunity for cyber criminals to intrude into anybody to take the data. So data, we also heard in the way that the previous panel saying data is the new oil, data is the new currency. When moving into digital is providing cyber groups in a silver platter, right? That's exactly what we are trying to do. How do we secure this? How do we ensure we need to address this part? The same data can also be a solution. When we say data is a problem, I would say data can also be a solution. That's exactly which we are heading into. We talked about the complicated equation. What do you think? Will innovation make payments more secure or more vulnerable? If you're wearing a security hat, it will say more vulnerable. If you're wearing a business hat, it will say it will be more secure, right? That's the state we are in. But the answer is both. The answer is both. It will solve for both if you are able to make a responsible innovation. How do we do this? How do we bring in this right balance between convenience and security? It's difficult. I'm not saying it's easy to do. But we need to keep in mind saying we need to balance this. And we feel data is the critical part in balancing this equation. How do we do it? I'm rushing through. I'm happy to take questions because the time allotted is very less, so I want to cover up maximum possible. Just to give you a glimpse of the global fraud rates which Visa has seen over the years, over the last say 20 plus years, it's only coming down. But absolute value is increasing. But in terms of fraud rates, it's only coming down because of technology innovations. We had just maxed cards, we introduced chip, which was brought down drastically. We had just card number, expiry date, we used for transaction, second factor authentication, VYV came into play, risk-based authentication came into play, further brought down. So there are a lot of technology innovation which has helped to bring down the fraud rates. But what we are seeing as a trend is the card not present. The remote payments, the fraud trends are only increasing. It's ballooning. So how do we address that? And the result on the other side, what we are seeing is a substantial increase in data breaches which are happening. These are not just card payment data breach. These are PII data breach. These are email IDs and passwords which are getting data breach. But these are close to, in 2017, it was close to 2 billion data which is breached. This was even, it's not even full year. It was taken in sometime in September, October. So it was close to 2 billion data breach. What it means is it's not just cards which are going to get affected. It's the identity information of a consumer which is breached, and that can result into identity theft for banks. So as an industry, as a banking community, we need to be more concerned on breaches. Though it's not related to bankers' data, it's going to affect the ecosystem. That's what we wanted to see. So having seen all this in terms of the drivers of change and where we're heading into, are we headed into a perfect risk storm? Probably yes. We are seeing, we talked about the card not present frauds are being exponentially growing and ballooning, and it's expected to be growing at 125% year on year. But that's what the trend we are seeing. On the other hand, on the business side, as we said, people are moving into more and more consumer experience based because there is a friction in the way the consumer transacts, because of which they are not able to complete the transaction. So that declines sales on a remote transaction or a card not present transaction is outpacing the fraud numbers. So there is a definite need for making the transaction more frictionless, but at the same time security has to be taken care of. We talked about 20 billion connected devices, and all are going to be payment carriers, and how do we balance this convenience? That's the $1 million question. And always worry from a security professional is who's going to be the next target. How is it going to affect my life? If somebody else gets breached, what is going to be my impact? The moment you read a breach article in a newspaper, is my consumer's data part of that breach? It's going to be a day-to-day activity for all of us. So this, I'd like to spend a couple of minutes on this slide. This is what we are thinking through as a strategy to address these evolving threats and the change in the landscape, right? First and foremost, what is the solution to address this complexity? The long-term solution is the first one, which is on the top left-hand side corner, is devaluing the data. We need to make this data worthless for criminals when it's probably proliferated into multiple players in the ecosystem. How do we do that? We did that in the card present environment, right? We made sure the chip was put into the plastic, just brought down the fraud rates considerably lower. Because even if a max type is counterfeited, if the chip is not read, the issuers have the capability to decline those transactions. These are suspicious counterfeit transactions which can come to the bankers, and they have the ability to block or decline these transactions. And chip read on a chip terminal is the most secure transaction. So we have seen this in the card present, but that's a one solution and easy to address that. But in a card not present, in a remote payment solution, you need to build layers of security. This is exactly, we talked about one layer is devaluing the data. What is the solution to devaluing the data? EMV for card present, we need to look at tokenizing the card number. So even if a token gets compromised, it's worthless to probably not be able to use that token and do another transaction. So that's the journey which we have started. We had examples of Apple Pay and Samsung Pay following the tokenization model. And this journey will take some time. For example, EMV, we started 25, 30 years back. We are reaping the benefits now because the entire globe has moved into EMV chip. Tokenization is a journey which we have started now, but it will not be a journey 30 years. We have already seen everything is moving faster. This will also move faster. Probably 5 years down the lane, we will see the benefits of tokenization. So that's the first and foremost thing which we need to do as a strategy. Till then, what do? We need to devalue data. We understand that's a journey which will bring, but till then, we need to protect the data. There are industry standards. PCI DSS is one of them, PADSS. There are other standards for PIN security. A lot of sensitive payment information can be protected by following global standards. So that's something which we need to continue to do that. PCI also has norms in terms of number of records and all that, but there are other. So basically, we need to think through any transit, any point-to-point encryption solution should be implemented. Even if you're not able to implement PCI, which is the highest level of standard, even if the data is moving from A to B, how can we protect it by building a P2P encryption solution? Is something which we need to think through. The bottom right is, the third one is harnessing data. When I talked about payment being a problem, data being a problem can also be a solution, right? How do we harness this data? With more and more payments moving into digital and moving into handed devices, the device becomes an extremely important information which is currently flowing to banks. How are we using this? How are we identifying exceptions? How do we know I as a consumer have the behavior of using my card, for example, booking a movie ticket for just give me 2 minutes. How do we identify saying I as a consumer use my device to book a movie ticket every weekend on my own device vis-a-vis my card credentials used by another device coming from a, I'm just giving an hypothetical example, from a Russian browser, Russian language. That should be, the bank should have this ability to differentiate this. Today data will aid them to do that, but people have to invest in solutions, technology solutions, and people process and person to do that. So that's, today data is available for backers. How do we harness this and ensure we manage security is something we need to think through. The last is, how do we make consumers be part of the journey to manage this? How do we empower consumers to manage his own card or an account? How do we give them the empowerment saying, if I am as a consumer is allowed to block my card and I'm sleeping? Because today alerts is one way of empowering the customer because he gets to know immediately. But what happens in the night? Most of the fraud happens because of time zone differences, happen in the night, right? They get to realize only in the morning. Can we give the ability of consumers managing their account, switching on, switching off for select transactions, for escape transactions? That's a journey which we need to think about when we talk about strategy. The last slide, we talked about balancing convenience and security, but keeping consumer in the center of our decisioning is equally important when we do all this, right? Because it's easier to say securing a transaction is important, but there is a saying, the most secure transaction is the transaction which never happened. We don't want to end up in that situation. We need to also go with the journey of digital, but ensure we balance this equation of convenience and security. You cannot think of a scenario saying there will be zero frauds in the area of cards or payment credentials. It will continue to be there because there are community which thrives on this doing frauds, right? They have families to feed. So you can't do away with frauds. It cannot be a zero-sum game. It has to be, they will continue to do it. It's the capability of how can you be better in managing this. So that can happen by collaborating. Mr. Pillai pointed out in the morning saying, how can we share information as a community? How can we ensure we have information available which can be shared with everyone who can build mitigants for the emerging trends? That's what I wanted to, we need to mobilize the industry and security. It is, everyone has a role to play, and I would like to end there. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, Shiva, for this insightful session and raising this question of balancing security and convenience in this connected world, which I think is the need of the hour. Thank you so much for that.